Hey guys, Alicia from Morning Hot Creations here. Today's eye study is in fact going to be a mandrill. Now, as surprising as it is, I have not found a whole lot of tutorials on drawing mandrills, and the reason I find this kind of interesting is that they are one of the most popular apes and monkeys that are in zoos because of their bright, bright coloration, and they were, as a species, featured in The Lion King. I mean, Rafiki is mandrill. So I was surprised when I went on YouTube and I did not find a whole lot of work going over mandrills. So this is going to be a quick one that's going to go over eyes specifically on mandrills. We're not really going to get into the banded fur that they have or any of the other anatomy features that they have. We're just going to focus on these eyes. Today we're going to be using three different kinds of colored pencil. We're going to be using the Fabre Castell, the Rose Art, which are ones that literally you can find at Walmart, and my usual Prisma colors. As you've seen, we'll be using the Finese colored pencil blender, which looks an awful lot like a marker. It has not been disclosed to me exactly what is in that colored pencil blender, although I suspect it's odorless mineral spirits. We are also going to be using the odorless mineral spirits loose. I did stop at Hobby Lobby and pick up a small container of that and a nice 1 ounce container with a screw-on lid, so that I can get at that more frequently. Now, one of the things that I want to point out about the mandrills is the specifics of their eye. Now, unlike other predators that have very characteristic eyes, where you're going to have a lot of detail in the iris and you spend a lot of time maybe doing the small variations in the stoma and on the iris, the crypsofuchs on the mandrill's iris are not quite so prominent, and those are the dips and ridges and the vascular layer that creates all of those highlights and lowlights and contrasts and characteristics that you find in many other animals like wolves and big cats. So that is not real prominent on a mandrill. So that is not an act of laziness on my part. They literally do not really exist on this mandrill. This mandrill was photographed at the Milwaukee Zoo, and he is a male. And male mandrills are really known for their bright colorations on their face and on their rear. Now this is kind of a visual cue to other male mandrills and to female mandrills of the sexual prowess and the age of a male mandrill. It is an easy way for other mandrills to tell whether or not a male, which may be in charge of a group of female mandrills, whether or not he is a viable mate or if he is a sizable challenger. The more colorful a male mandrill is, the more viable he is as a mate and a challenger. So a lot of color on a male is a good thing. Now, mandrills are considered to be an old world monkey and are found in Cameroon, Gabon, the Equatorial Guinea, and the Congo, which I find a little weird that they included them in The Lion King because that's a very small part of Africa and it's very much the tropical rainforest area of Africa. So to depict them in a savanna setting I thought was a little interesting. I would have figured that to be more of a standard baboon kind of thing, but it's Disney and so they probably wanted to go with the most colorful baboon that they could find in, so let's go with a mandrill. One of the things that always impressed me about mandrills is their really, really intense stare. Now, mandrills are omnivores, and a male mandrill, which can be somewhere in the area of 45 to 50 pounds, has about a 2-inch fang. It's actually, on average, about 1.8 inches. And it's got really a rather intimidating bite. But I've always kind of noticed that for something that's an omnivore like a bear, they have this very, very intense stare. They're definitely very intelligent creatures, but they always have this kind of, aggressive, posture to them. And around the eyes, I'm not putting too much color. I will come back a little bit with the quote unquote raspberry color, which is closer to a quinacridone red, kind of a cooler red, just to give it some amount of fleshy tone. But primarily, right around the eyes, you're going to stick to the grays and the blacks. You can kind of tell as I'm getting this kind of underlying the under eye area here, where you can tell the tooth of the paper definitely has this left to right kind of tooth. And it does, to me, because I'm used to very detailed work, it detracts from the piece, which is why I do wind up going in heavily later with the odorless mineral spirits and kind of getting this really saturated into the tooth of the paper and then going over it again. And this Finesse pencil blender does work like a marker, and it does do superficial blending. But for such large areas like under the eye, I felt it really wasn't getting into the tooth of the paper, and it was going to kind of max out the capacity of what this marker could do, and I didn't want to wear it out. So at some point, I did switch from that Finesse pencil to the odorless mineral spirits, so I wasn't taxing that tool too much. It does work really well for small areas, such as in the iris and in the areas of the eye, such as the tear duct, but for larger areas around the eye, underneath the eye, in the face, you'll see me using the odorless mineral spirits much more because it's a larger area. One of the things that I thought was kind of unusual about doing these mandrills is that sectioning of the upper eyelid. And it's mostly just creasing. It's not like this is scaled at all. But think of something similar to how like a crocodile's eye is, where it's just very sectioned and there's creases and dips in there. And that's what I was kind of thinking of as I was re-rendering that upper eyelid. That's what it made me think of, even though that all this was just very creased. It was, in fact, not plated, but that is what it really made me think of. Not smooth like a big cat. Much more thick. A good word for it. So in this upper eyelid, before we actually get into the furred area of the mandrill's face, you do have an awful lot of fleshy tones coming in. This is the beginning of that really, really bright color that mandrills have. So using an awful lot of browns and blues, along with those grays and blacks, to bring out some amount of color. Because I really don't want this to be overshadowed by just that overwhelming grayness that is in the lower eyelid. and going through with some of the other tones of brown. Some of these are closer to a burnt sienna, and combining those with the reds and the quinacridone reds does give you that more fleshy tone. And of course, then covering this up with some of the mineral spirits and blending that pigment into the paper. It does intensify the color quite a bit, so then I can go in and bring in some more color. And going into the other eye. Now, this eye, and on most pairs of eyes, you're going to find one that's a little bit closer to the light source than the other. In this case, the first eye we did was closer to the light source, and this is actually the darker of the two eyes. So instead of sticking to the brighter cadmium yellows and oranges, we're going to get more in to the yellow ochres and the browns in order to put this eye farther back and give it some distance, and also put it a little bit more in the shadows without bringing in a whole bunch of grays. And again, the vascular area of mandrills does not leave a lot of texture for the iris, so this would have to be a very flat region. Very smooth blending is required here, rather than accenting certain vascular characteristics in the iris. Originally, I did want to kind of keep some of these eyelashes real prominent when I did this, and that was in order to retain the integrity of those eyelashes, so I didn't forget to put them in. And by the time I actually got really far down into doing this eye, I decided I had changed my mind and I really didn't want to retain that. Another characteristic of mandrills is that outer eyelid, where that very small, it's a couple of millimeter distance, where you see the white of the eye and the edge of the iris, compared to the actual red of the eye. Now, they're, the white of your human eye equates to the red of their eye. So there's a very small band where the iris actually forms back into the muscle and the base of their eye. And so rather than just forming it in blues or blacks and browns, we do need to bring in a little bit of blue to help push that back without losing the dimensions and the punchiness of that white. And going back through and coming back to that first eye we started, just kind of helping to define that upper eyelid. And I do want to retain some of the wrinkles and the texture of that upper eyelid. But I'm gonna have to kind of tone that down a little bit because the actual flesh color is very dark. It's a dark gray, almost black color. So there's a little bit of light reflectivity in there, but I don't want that to overpower the eye itself. So we're gonna darken all this in just so I could push it back just a bit. Layering in more color here where we've already gone over with the odorless mineral spirits. And we'll just kind of keep going back and forth. Let me get some more intense color. And getting the mineral spirits in just to get that really worked into the tooth of the paper and get rid of all the kind of white spots that are being caused just by the tooth of the paper existing. I've heard some people complain pro and con to different brands of color pencils, and I did really like the fact that the Fabre Castell did go on really very smoothly. It left me a really sharp edge between the Rose Art, which is a Walmart brand. It's a very generic brand. You can buy like 120 for about like a, you know, probably like 12 bucks, I think. And the fabric or the Prisma color, which are about $2 a piece, I didn't find too much difference in how they laid down or how they sharpened or the color impact. I think some of the problems that some people have had, maybe how they're using them. I tend to use many thinner layers rather than to lay them down real heavy. That's just the way I've always worked. I've always worked in multiple layers rather than gobbing on a huge heavy layer. You'll also see me at times taking the actual side of the pencil just to lay in some overall color into an area. But I think it's quite possible that those artists that are complaining that cheaper pencils have a tendency of breaking, or they have bad wood or something. I have not seen that. And taken into consideration that the Prismacolors that I own, I have owned for something close to 15 or 20 years, and it is entirely possible that Prismacolor has let their quality standards decline. However, I have not had a problem with that. The Rose Art pencils that I have that I'm using in this piece, I bought 4 years ago just because I needed a couple of extra ones that were in there, and it was cheaper than driving to Milwaukee and going to Blick Art Materials for those specific pencils. So I have so far included those in my repertoire of colored pencils and not had a huge problem with using them. The addition of using this colorless mineral spirits was kind of a trip. Definitely something that I kind of wished I knew a couple years ago. Because, as you can see, it just does a fabulous job of just taking and integrating all of that pigment into the paper. And even with something as toothy as this watercolor paper, it does a wonderful job just making better use of the pigment that is laid down on the paper. Thank you. And the only parts of the mandrill's face that are really truly just very, very black are basically that lower lid and the very upper, just the tip of the eyelid. Everything else starts to get pretty colored. And again, this is a male, so it's going to be much more colored in the face as it goes down across into the bridge of the nose and underneath the eyes. You're going to see that those bright blue patches on the cheeks are going to come into play, although because this is an eye study, I'm not going to focus on that primarily, but I'm going to make an indication of it. So with mandrills, the upper ridge of the eyelid and the lower eyelid seems to be the only real place where you're going to have a lack of color. And again, just in with the odorless mineral spirits to kind of blend that pigment into the tooth of the paper so I can go in with another layer. I did find that using the odorless mineral spirits did make the pencils last longer. It was less frustrating. It was a little bit more of an immediate result rather than endless layers of trying to get it into a very toothy surface. You know, just working on the one of those two banded cheek areas, and again with the males, lots of color in these faces. So lots of blue in those white cheeks, and lots of bright reds and oranges in the balance of the stripe down the middle of the face. Although it seems to me that this is kind of an older mandrill. He's got some age spots going on. So I would probably have to check back if anybody's interested in checking the actual age of this mandrill. And for those that are interested in actually painting these guys, your overall skin tone, once you get underneath the fur, is primarily dark grays and blacks, which is what helps that ticked fur and that banded fur stand out so wonderfully and so exotically, is that very, very dark skin. Mandrills have some very, very intense color to their eyes, so there was a lot of going back and forth and layering in more color as I kind of felt it was needed. Some of the white ticking that I'm actually seeing that is happening on the left hand of the screen is actually from the lights hitting the paper rather than a lack of pigment on the paper. It's actually the tooth of the paper that's getting picked up by the light. I did try and go through and do this. I did this in two different sessions. So, as you can see, I originally tried to go through and put these eyelashes in with, or these whiskers in with pencil. It didn't quite take. I didn't have the intensity that I wanted, so I did go through with some acrylic paint, put them in. And I am putting in the kind of outer hairs that are around the face. Mostly just as a kind of a tonation for myself, that this is about where the fur line goes, and so if I ever want to go through and do a mandrill, which would actually be very, very challenging, that I have kind of an idea for any future references that that's about where it goes. Hope you enjoyed. Please don't forget to subscribe for more. Thanks for watching.